Hi there. Welcome to Rampart Christian Fellowship. Today is November 29th, 2015, and we are in the 13th part in a series of messages titled The Attributes of God. And this series is basically, let me break it down for you. At Rampart, we desire to have a full spectrum view of God. We want you to understand who God is, all of his different characteristics, and what he is like. And so we believe that that the better our understanding of God, the better equipped we will be to serve God. And so in this series, The Attributes of God, it's designed to help us grow in our knowledge and the faith of God. There's a preacher that I follow online. His name's Paul Washer. And he did a series called Behold Your God, or he was part of a series called Behold Your God. And one of the things he says, one of the greatest needs in Christianity today is to have a greater understanding of God. And I completely agree. I think that as we grow in our understanding of who God is, we will definitely change the way we live, because our life is a reflection of what we believe. And so if we believe that God is all these wonderful things that we've been going over for the past 3 months, I think it will change the way we live and the things that we do. In Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 through 24, it says, "Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor let the rich glory in his riches, but let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me. That I am the Lord, exercising loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For these I delight, says the Lord." So if there's anything that we should boast in, if there's anything that we should take some pride in, is that we know who God is. And so I just encourage you to, if you've missed any of the messages, they're all available on through our website or on our YouTube channel or even on our Facebook page. Our website is www.rampart505.com. So there's also another series called The Attributes of God available from legionnaire.org, which is a ministry of R.C. Sproul. Okay, so today, in part 13 of The Attributes of God, we are going to go over the truthfulness of God. And it's a very important attribute of God, how God is the truth, how he is always truthful. In John chapter 8, verse 32, it says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." You might have heard that before. That comes straight out of the Gospel of John. It's the words of Jesus Christ. And he said that when you know the truth is going to make you free. So think about your life. Think about the things that can hold you down, like addictions or relationships or the just depression, all these things that can hold us back in life. He says, when you know the truth will set you free from that. So what you want is more truth. And God is truth. It says the truthfulness of God is a vital attribute for us to know and love about God. The fact that God is truth, and that he only speaks the truth, and that he only does what is true, gives us a great confidence in our relationship with God. We can trust God because of his truthfulness. Don't you hate somebody that always tells you something but never follows through with what they say? You know, it's the people who speak lies. It really gets to me when somebody says, you know, says one thing to my face, but then it does a totally different thing behind my back. Well, God's not like that. God always does what he says he's going to do. God is faithful. He is truthful. He is the truth. Amen. So let's jump into to the Bible and see what the Word of God says about God's truthfulness. If you don't have a Bible, there's one, should be one underneath the seat in front of you. And if you don't have a handout, they're on the thing right there. But the first verse that we're going to jump into is in the book of Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4. And this is speaking about God. It says, "He is the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are justice. A God of truth and without injustice, righteous and upright is he." So who is God? He is that rock. He is unchanging. He is, and all his work is perfect. The week after next, we're going to talk about the names of God. And that's one of the names of God, the God of truth. And so we can hold on to that truth about God, that all his ways are perfect. Amen? And let's jump into the book of Psalms. Psalms chapter 31, verse 5. This is not an extensive or exhaustive list of all the verses that talk about God's truthfulness. There's many, many more, but I wanted to highlight a few of them this morning. Psalm 31, chapter 5, or verse 5, I'm sorry. Psalm chapter 31, verse 5. It says, "Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord God of truth." And it's kind of like what Stephen says when he was getting stoned to death. He says, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." And it's kind of just this surrendering to God. This is a psalm of David in Psalm 31. It says, "Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O God of truth." Again, he's identified as the God of truth. Amen. Let's go to the book of Isaiah. Chapter 65, Isaiah 65, verse 16. Isaiah chapter 65, verse 16 says, "So that he who blesses himself in the earth shall bless himself in the God of truth, and he who swears on the earth shall swear by the God of truth, because the former troubles are forgotten, because they are hidden from my eyes, says the Lord." And so, again, we see that God's, twice in that verse, that he is referred to as the God of truth. And then I wanted to cover a few more verses just from the Gospel of John. And basically, the whole Gospel of John speaks to the truthfulness of God and the person of Jesus Christ being the truth. As we saw in John 8:32, it says, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Let's see what else it says in the book of John, the Gospel of John. It says Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, chapter 14, verse 6. And this should be a verse that you probably want to memorize, that you want to commit to your heart. I got it on the bumper of my car. It says, "Jesus said to him, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So understand that Jesus made an explicit claim about himself, that he wasn't a way, that he wasn't a truth, and he wasn't a life. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father. And so it's interesting how he says that right there. Because if something is true, if we understand something to be true, then that excludes everything else. Truth, by definition, is narrow. And we're going to get into that a little more in a few minutes. But understand that Jesus said he is the truth, an explicit truth. And so we should look at Jesus, and you have to consider in your heart what you believe about Jesus. Do you believe that verse right there is the truth? And I believe if you take that verse to heart and you believe what it says right there, what Jesus said about himself. C.S. Lewis wrote a book called Mere Christianity. And in that book, he presented something called Liar, Lunatic, or Lord. And so when you look at this verse, John 14, 6, you could say that Jesus Christ was either lying when he said that he is the way, the truth, and life, or he was a lunatic. He thought he was the way, the truth, and life, but he really wasn't. Or he actually is who he says he was. And so it's like a trilemma right there. And you have to decide where you're going to put your faith. For me personally, for the past 9 years, I have put my faith in that being a true statement from the Lord of glory, from Jesus Christ, God incarnate. Amen? So, and then if we jump down a little further in verse 17 of John 14, it says, "The Spirit of truth." Well, let's go back to verse 15. It says, "If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever." In verse 17, it says, "The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But for he dwells with dwells with you and will be in you. And not only, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. So this is where Jesus is talking about when he's going. After he dies on the cross and after he ascends, he says he will send a helper, the Holy Spirit. And his name, another name, is the Spirit of Truth. So you have Jesus saying that he is the truth. Then he says he's sending the Spirit of Truth. And we know God as the God of Truth. And so we kind of see a picture of the Trinity right there. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, all making the explicit claim of being the truth. And so for the past 9 years, I have put my faith in a triune God who expresses himself in three distinct persons. And they are all the absolute expression of truth. Amen? Let's go to the next chapter over, John 15, verse 26. John chapter 15, verse 26, and this speaks to about the Holy Spirit again. It says, "But when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father," again, this is Jesus speaking, talking about sending someone from the Father, the Spirit of Truth who proceeds from the Father. He didn't say a, he says he, the Spirit of Truth, he will testify of me. And also, and you also will bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. So he says that God the Spirit is going to proceed from the Father, and he, meaning a person, is going to testify of Christ. Again, we see the Trinity as the truth. Amen? And then John chapter 16, verse 13. John chapter 16, verse 13. It says, "However, when he," again, the Spirit of Truth, "has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will tell you the things to come." That's interesting. The Spirit of God is going to tell you what's going to happen. How can God know what's going to happen? Because he knows all things. We talked about that a few weeks ago, how God is omniscient. He knows what's going to happen. He's already predestined it to come to pass. And so he knows all things, and he declares the truth about all things. Amen? So how does this whole thing about God's truthfulness apply to our lives? How is this supposed to impact us? The truth of God should be the narrow path that we as Christians, that we walk as Christians. Truth by definition is narrow, and so the truth is a clear guide in times of trouble. So when life gets crazy, when we don't know where to go, when we're wondering, man, I don't know what's going to, we can go to God and go to his truth as a clear path, because truth is going to guide us. It's not going to lead us all kinds of crazy ways. If we follow the truth, we're going to go one straight and narrow way. So let us hold fast to these truths. And the first one I wanted to highlight is in Matthew chapter 7. It says, God's truth is not relative. And so we live in a postmodern era when relativism is rampant in our society. What is relativism? Relativism is when you say, you have your truth and I have my truth. And everybody's truth is just their own relative truth to them. But the truth of God is absolute truth. It's true for everybody at all times, everywhere. And so when you embrace Jesus Christ as being absolute truth, that's what it talks about in Matthew chapter 7. Let's turn there real quick. Matthew chapter 7 is probably one of my favorite chapters in the whole Bible, because it's part of what's called the Sermon on the Mount, and it really gets into some deep, deep theology, gets into some deep understanding of and warnings about what's going to come. So in Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 13, this is what it says. I'm going to read down a few verses, but it says, Father God, we just pray for whoever that ambulance is going to. Pray that you help them and meet them. Amen. In Jesus' name. So it's in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13, it says, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, for there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to life, and there are few who find it." So you can just take those two verses right there and think about those verses, what they say. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. "Enter by the narrow gate, For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. In the world that we're in today, there is a lot of broad ways that everybody is going down. A lot of lies that everybody wants to believe. Everybody wants to think that selfishness and self-esteem is what's going to get you happiness in life. So you got to get yours. You got to build your own self up. And that's part of the broad way. He says narrow is the way and difficult is the one that leads to life. And that difficult, narrow path is the one where you don't look at yourself and try and build yourself up. You die to yourself and you live to help others and to glorify God. It says, what does it say? It says, beware the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. So it says that we should beware. Jesus Christ is giving us a warning right there. He says there's false prophets. And I tell you, there's false prophets out here today. And they will tell you that you just need to worry about you. You just need to worry about your happiness, your job, your situation. You don't need to worry about anybody else. You just need to build your life up and have good self-esteem. But that's not the truth. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit. Every bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear good fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. So he says it's very plain here. If you have the truth, if you're on the narrow path, you're going to bear good fruit. If you're not on the narrow path, if you're on the broad path, you're going to bear. And in the church, in Christianity today, a lot of people say, oh, I know Jesus. I love Jesus. But their lives do not bear any good fruit that goes along with knowing Jesus and loving Jesus. They'll be at the club on Friday or Saturday night, and then they'll be in church in morning, and they'll just be living like hell. And the truth that I've been getting over the past 9 years of reading this book is if you live like hell, you're not going to heaven. Apostle Paul said it. He says, if you live this way, do not be deceived. You will reap what you sow. And so if a good tree does not bear bad fruit. Again, it says every tree, in verse 19, it says every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. And by your fruits you will know yourself. In 2 Corinthians 13:5, it says, examine yourself. Look at yourself. Test yourself. Do you now not know that Christ is in you? Unless you are disqualified. He says, but I have confidence that you're not disqualified. The Apostle Paul was telling the church in Corinth to look at themselves. Look at the fruit in their life. This is the truth. And then this is the craziest, this is the scariest verse in the whole Bible for me. Look what it says in verse 21 of Matthew chapter 7. It says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons in your name? Have done many wonders in your name? And this is what it says. Jesus Christ will say, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. And underline that word practice. It's very, you have to understand. It's not that if you're going to be a Christian, you're not going to ever sin or have a evil thought. It's that if you're a Christian, if you're walking with Christ, you're going to live as a manner of life, something that's going towards godliness and away from sin. So those who practice lawlessness with no repentance, no conviction in their heart, he says he will declare to them, I never knew you. And the crazy thing is, I think we kind of isolate to those people that are outside of the church. And I think we need to take notice that he's talking to the disciples. He's talking to the church. And so what kind of lawlessness would he be talking about? For me, what I'm more convinced of every single day, the lawlessness that he's talking about of is pride, is looking at oneself higher than we ought to think. And thinking, and pride and selfishness and greed are all up in the church right now. And I think we need to turn from that. We need to repent of that. We need to look towards others. We need to share the gospel, share the good news with other people. Because I don't want to hear Jesus say, depart from me, I never knew you. And I'm going to say, oh, well, I preached in the, I did Bible studies. I went, no, he's going to say, if you practice lawlessness, I never knew you. So there, and then he says it right here in verse 24. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. We just talked about earlier how God is the rock. And he says, and the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on the house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them, do you don't believe that this is truth, will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rains descended and the floods came and the winds blew and they beat on the house and it fell, and great was its fall. That's the most shocking, sobering piece of scripture right there that I've read out of the whole Bible. It says, beware. There's false prophets. They're going to tell you to live your life and get your best life now. But beware of them. You will know them by their fruits. He says, walk the narrow way. And it's a hard, difficult way because it's a self-sacrificial way. And so if you hear these things and you do them, you'll be like a wise man. And so what I try and do when I read the truth of Scripture, I read it like it's actually true. Like this is real. This is what needs to happen in my life. And when I fall short, because the Bible says that everybody falls short of the glory of God, I get on my knees nightly and pray. Say, Lord, change me. Lord, help me. Lord, I have mercy upon me, a sinner. You know, Jesus said that there was two men that went up to pray, a parable. And one was a Pharisee, a religious man. And he prayed like this. He said, God, thank you for not making me like this tax collector, this sinner over here. Thank you for not making me a woman or a dog. You know, he's just thanking God for, because he's all that and then some. And then the other guy came to pray, was the tax collector. He couldn't even look up to God. He would just beat his chest and say, Lord, have mercy upon me, a sinner. And Jesus said, I tell you the truth, that tax collector went home justified that day. So we need to understand, God is looking at our hearts. He's looking at us to confess before Him, say, God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. You know, and heed the words that He gives us and receive them as truth. Amen? So God's truth is not relative. The second one is God's truth is God's Word. In Psalm 119, which is another powerful piece of Scripture, I used to just fast and pray the whole of Psalm 119. Because it's such an awesome picture of someone pouring their heart out to God, where you just really cry out to God and tell God that you want to know His ways and know what He wants for your life. And in Psalm 119, verse 160, it's close to the end of the Psalm. It's like the longest chapter in the whole Bible. It says, "The entirety of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous judgments endures forever." So the entirety of God's word is truth. And so if you want to know God and His truthfulness, then you need to get to know God's word. And you need to not just read it like you're reading through some book. This is the words of the eternal God. You need to take this stuff to heart. You know, I mean, I'm big for memorizing Scripture, and I thank God that He's given me kind of a gift. And I don't go through all kinds of memorization techniques. For me, I'll just be reading somewhere like Matthew 7:13, and when something touches my heart, I'll read it over and over and over again. I'll write it down somewhere. I'll put it, you know, all over. I remember when I read Romans 8:28 for the first time, it touched my heart. It says, "For we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purposes." And I was like, so I set my watch to 8:28. So every time that my watch alarm would go off, I would read Romans 8:28, just so I would get that truth into my heart. And so if we want to know the truth of God, we need to not just read the Word of God, but soak in the Word of God. Get to know it. Get to know it like it was a letter from the person who loves you, because it is. He loves you so deeply. And what does John 3:16 say? We should memorize that one, right? "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, and whoever should believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And so that's what this truth is. This is the truth from God, and it should be His expression of how much He loves us, that He gives us this word, and it's a guide down that narrow path that we were talking about. Amen? Amen. And God's truth is immutable. We talked about God's immutability a few weeks ago, how the word immutable does not change. It means something does not change. It's like that way forever. And God's truth is His truth forever. When God says it, it will come to pass, right? And so before we get into that closing verse, I wanted to touch on a couple more verses that I didn't even put in the notes. But my life verse, and I'm sure if you've come here a few times, you probably heard me quote it, but Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. That's That, you know, what's a life verse? Well, when you start reading the Bible and start studying the Bible, you might come across a verse that just speaks to you, that just sticks to you, that sticks in your head. And that could be your life verse. And this is my, it's actually two verses, but this is what has stuck to my life for the past 9 years. That's Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him and He shall direct your path." So trust in the Lord with all of your heart. The only way you can trust somebody with all of your heart is if you believe that they are truthful. And God is truth. So the only way I'm able to trust God with all of my heart, with every one of my situations, with every one of my problems, I can do that because He is the truth. And I'm not leaning on my own understanding, but I'm trusting in Him. When you get caught up in a spot and you don't know where to go, I encourage you, trust in God. He will guide you. He's right there. You can trust Him every time. So I was talking to my son one time, and he was like, "I just want to know what God wants from me." I was like, well, picture this, son. What if Jesus came and sat down next to you and put His hand on your shoulder, and He asked you, will you trust me? Would you trust Him? If Jesus came up to you and asked you, will you trust me? That's what happened to me 9 years ago. I mean, I was in a jail cell. And I was facing a 9-year prison sentence, and I was an atheist. I didn't believe in any of this. But God put His hand on my shoulder, basically, and asked me to trust Him. And I said, yes. I said, I will trust you, God. And He has done miracles, continually done miracles, guided me through into this narrow path over the past 9 years. And I'd say right now, I encourage you. He is asking each and every one of us to trust Him. And I encourage you to do it. Trust Him with your entire life. He is faithful. He is the truth, right? And then another one before we get into the closing verse is in the book of 1 John, which is close to the end of your Bible, near the book of Revelation. And I love the book of 1 John because it gives us these qualified statements. It says, by this we can know. You know, it's like, how do I know if God loves me? Or how do I know if I'm saved? How do I know anything? Well, in the book of 1 John, it tells you, by this you know. It says, look at this. This is the message you have heard in 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. It says, this is the message which you have heard from Him and declare it to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. And we're talking about God being truth, right? If we walk in the light as He in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Here's another one. If we say that we have no sin, in verse 8, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. And verse 9 is a beautiful one. You should probably memorize it. If we confess our sins, God is faithful. We can trust Him and just to forgive us of all our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word, which is His truth, is not in us. And so it says in verse 3 of chapter 2, now by this we know that we know Him, if we keep His commandments. He who says, I know Him, and does not keep His commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. So how do we know if we know God? By keeping His commandments. You mean the Old Testament Ten Commandments? Well, when Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment in the whole law? They sent a lawyer up to go test Jesus. Well, Jesus said, He says, I tell you the truth that you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. You should love your neighbor as yourself. He says, on those two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So the whole Old Testament hangs on those two commandments. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you do that, you fulfill all the Ten Commandments. And so it says, he who says, I know Him, and does not keep His commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. So by this we know that we know Him, if we keep His commandments. The Ten Commandments? No, the two commandments. Love God with all your heart, and love your neighbor as yourself. So what if you said, well, I haven't been doing that. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to die. He's going to say, I never knew you. No, you still have breath in your lungs. If you hear what I'm saying, you still have time to repent, to turn from that. You say, Lord, I hear your words. I hear your truth. I receive it. I turn from not loving you. I turn from not loving my neighbor. I ask you to transform me and cause me to walk on that narrow path. Christianity is not about you being religious. It's about a supernatural act of God coming and turning your life around and putting you on that narrow path. You don't have to get all beat down and broken when you see that you haven't been doing what God has called you to do. You need to do what the scripture says, which is repent. The word repent means to change. It means to change your mind and to change, like do a 180 and go the other way. See, you're blessed right now to have breath in your lungs. You have the ability to hear God's truth and receive it into your heart and change the path, change the way you're going. And all it is, it takes you crying out to God from your heart. Say, God, change me. God, transform me. God, guide me in that path. And I promise you, if you do that, you will be able to pass the test. It says, by this we know that we know him, that we keep his commandments, by loving him with all our heart and loving our neighbor as ourselves. And I tell you, when I hold my life up to that standard, I often see that, man, I'm not loving God with all my heart, or I'm not loving my neighbor as myself. So it keeps me in a continual pattern of humbleness. I'm humble before God. I'm trusting that he's going to transform me and continue to transform me into the person he wants me to be. And so I don't get all beat down and broken. I just get humble before God, and I trust him. Now, that's the other thing. I trust him to do his good will in my life. Amen? So finally, in the book of Revelation, we see this picture, right? In Revelation chapter 19, verse 11. Revelation chapter 19. Now, this the book of Revelation is crazy, right? It's the end of the world. It's the wrath of God being poured out on the earth. All the sin, all the wickedness, all the people who are selling little girls into slavery, all the people who are raping and beating people, all that sin that's going on in the world is storing up wrath, is storing up God's wrath. And in the book of Revelation, the wrath of God is poured out on the earth. And it says, if it wasn't for the grace of God, he said, no flesh would live. All the evil is going to be dealt with. There is justice, and it's coming from Jesus Christ. And it says in verse 11 of Revelation chapter 19, let's see, it says, now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called faithful and what? True. and in righteousness he judges and makes war. And his eyes are like fire, like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written on that no one knew except himself, and he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. In the beginning of the book of John, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that the Word of God is Jesus Christ. And when he comes back to bring God's judgment upon this earth, he's coming back with the sword. And he says that all the wrong that is on this planet will be dealt with. But understand that his righteous judgments are true. But he says before that day, he has given the gospel to be spread into the world. You have the opportunity right now to turn to him and embrace him as the truth. Not just a truth, oh, you have your truth, as the absolute truth. You can do that today. You can do that right now. You can do that until it's too late, and you won't have a chance to do that, and you will be subject to the wrath of God. So I encourage anybody who hears this, take a time. Get serious between you and God. And receive his forgiveness. Receive his mercy, because he loves you. He said he loves you so much he sent his son to die for you. Amen? So that's what I have about the truthfulness of God. And there's much more to be said. But I encourage you to just trust in God. You know, it's the Spirit of God that does a greater work than any preacher can bring. You know, I can bring all the knowledge and wisdom of God, but it's the Spirit of God that needs to touch your heart and do the transformation. So I just encourage you, you know, no matter where you're at, no matter what your relationship is with God, that you would spend some time seriously considering his ways and humbling yourself before him. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, you are so good, and you're so graceful, gracious, Lord. I pray for anyone who hears this message that they would consider these truths, consider your truthfulness, and put their trust solely in you, Lord. I pray for all the people in this community that are still struggling with drugs, alcohol, and domestic violence, all the things that are going on right now as we speak, Lord. I pray that your hand of grace would fall upon it, that you would draw them out of that darkness and draw them into your peace, Lord. Draw them into light by any means necessary. We thank you for the work that you're doing right now, the work that you're going to do, and all that you've done. So we just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Got one closing song. Oops.
Full of stress. A lot put to this right here.